One of the things that I absolutely love to do with Hyler, take him out in the driveway, put him on my knee, put him in our rocking chair, and we just have a steady flow of air traffic over our house. It's so much fun, and to watch his reaction as a plane flies overhead, and I tell him to wave at the plane. And as he waves at the plane, I oftentimes do a voice of a pilot, as though he's talking to everyone else on the plane, looking at Hyler. I'll do something like, "Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, if you could please look out the right side of the aircraft, you'll see Hyler Daniel Duffy with big old muscles and a brand new shirt on." And usually when I do something like that, Hyler just dies laughing. It's this idea that God, for whatever reason, would speak all things into being, all creation into being, and yet at the same time, know us so intimately. Not only that, that God would move in such a way in our lives that he would be intimately invested in our problems and our worries and our concerns. Sometimes we think that God just spoke all things into being and then just flew off, never to return again, never interested again, and just kind of allows things and calamities and hardships and difficulties and trials to befall us all, too busy to worry or to notice each and every one of us. But that's not actually the character or the story of God at all. Scripture tells us that Jesus would actually touch down on this earth. He would walk in the human condition while also being God. He would interact with our worries and our fears and our concerns and death and heartache and disease. Jesus understood the pain of human suffering and understood the intimate details of human beings. And Psalm 139 sums up this tension, this beautiful tension of God speaking all things into being and knowing all things on such a vast level, and yet knowing each and every one of us, knowing you so intimately to your innermost being. Psalm 139 would say it this way: "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them." Because Jesus would touch down on this earth, walk amongst us, live a sinless and perfect life, he would suffer and die, defeating sin, death, and Satan. And believe it or not, Jesus not only loves you, he likes you, and he knows you. And it's for those reasons, that beautiful sacrifice of dying and rising again, his unbelievable love for you, combined with his unbelievable power over all things. One day, Jesus will take you and he will take me back up into the heavens.